हेलो,
मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल।
కంపెనీ లో సండే లో పెట్టాను, రిక్వెస్ట్ చేసి నిన్న దాకా టైం ఇచ్చాను. ఇప్పుడు మొదటి అట్లీస్ట్ ఫోటో ఉన్న పర్లేదు సార్. అంటే నేను స్కాన్
हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल. वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट आवर फर्स्ट सेशन ऑफ सेकंड डे ऑफ एफबीपी. आई प्रोफेसर जी ए पटेल, हेड ऑफ इलेक्ट्रिकल इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट, गवर्नमेंट इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज पाटन, एंड कोऑर्डिनेटर ऑफ दिस एफबीपी, वेलकम ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट एंड eminent speaker of this session, Dr. S.K. Singhal sir. Sir is head and professor of Hydro and Renewable Energy Department, IIT Roorkee. So it's my pleasure to welcome such renowned speaker. Sir, thank you very much for sparing and accepting our invitation and spared your valuable time to share knowledge with our participants. So thanks again. Now I request Professor H.P. Patel sir to give brief introduction of sir and start session of today's day.
Good morning all participants, and namaskar sir. Dr. Sunil Kumar Singhal, head and professor of Hydro and Renewable Energy Department, IIT Roorkee. Roorkee is a ancient engineering institute. It will complete 175 years of its establishment in year 2022, means next year. It is a very historical institute. Sir has done his ME, BE and PhD from IIT Roorkee. Sir is having 35 years of teaching experience. He is working on research projects sponsored by National Hydro Power Corporation and Uttarakhand Jal Vidyut Nigam Limited. Research area of sir is small hydropower, resource potential assessment, investigation, cost optimization, tariff analysis, integrated renewable energy system, management of water resources. Under his supervision, 8 PhD theses awarded and 5 in progress, 81 ME student theses awarded and 5 in progress. Sir had research publication 92 papers from national and international journals, 124 in workshop, conference and seminar, 13 book chapter and special publication. Sir has consultancy and sponsored research projects of various states. He is having international projects like in Canada, Uganda, Cambodia, Sri Lanka, Zambia and European Union. Sir has membership of very renowned institute, and sir has many international visits also. So I welcome sir, and on behalf of GEC Patan, I invite you to visit World Heritage Site Rani Ki Vav, which is just near to our institute, and it is very famous in world today because it is reflected on our 100 rupees Indian currency note also. Patan is also famous for his patola, and sir, I welcome you to start the session.
Thank you, Professor G.A. Patel and Professor Harshad Patel and other team members of the organizing team. I congratulate the team for organizing such a wonderful program sponsored by Atal Academy. And during this pandemic period, most of the program they are being organized online. There are advantage and disadvantage. Advantage is it's convenient to join because we can skip the travel for long distances. But if you come physically at different places, that's also good because we learn many things from each other. But anyway, whatever the situation is, we have to go by that. And let me share my presentation and then we'll talk more on that issue. And if you have any query, even you can hold me in between also, or you can have the queries at the end also, as you wish. I have no reservation for that. So let me share my presentation. Is it visible?
Yes, sir, visible.
Fine. So I'll be talking on the small hydropower potential assessment and investigations. Let me brief about the department. The department alternate at the Department of Hydro and Renewable Energy is a unique department of IIT Roorkee, which was established in the year 1982 with the name Alternate Hydro Energy Center. And in April 2019, it has become full-fledged department of IIT Roorkee with the new name, Department of Hydro and Renewable Energy, where we are working on development of hydropower, renewable energy, and environmental aspects of water bodies. Regarding the energy, of course, it is important input for the development or for everything, whether it's a trade and commerce, production, transportation, agriculture, domestic needs, or service sector. Or even we are connected this time and listening to each other. It's also due to the energy and the internet. Without energy, we cannot think of. So energy, it's also a measure of development of any society or a country. The sources of energy from which we get energy, or in the form, convenient form of energy, is the electricity, the thermal, hydropower, and nuclear, which are known as conventional or non-renewable energy sources. Although hydropower, whether it's small or large, is now a renewable source of energy. But these conventional sources have associated problems. Like thermal, the problem is the availability of the fuel, which is not in abundance. Also, during the course of the thermal generation, it puts a lot of emissions, which is harmful to the environment in the form of GHG emissions. Hydropower, if you talk for a large hydropower with high dam and large reservoirs, the problem is the submergence and resettlement. In Gujarat, you might have seen the development of Sardar Sarovar Dam. There may be still some issues related to resettlement. But you can also appreciate the Saurashtra and Kutch region. There has been a tremendous change due to availability of the water, because this is all arid region. Nuclear power plants, they also have the associated problem of safety and security. The safety from the radiations from nuclear power plant, which are harmful for the person working over there and also living in the area. And the fuel which is used for power generation in nuclear power plant can also be used in making the nuclear bombs. So that's why the safety and security is a very crucial aspect in nuclear power generation. In the non-conventional energy sources, which are of course renewable, solar, small hydro, geothermal, tidal, we do not have such kind of problems, and that's why the focus is now shifting towards the non-conventional renewable energy sources, although I would say that they are no more non-conventional now. If you see the installed capacity, still more than 60% contribution come from the thermal sources. Hydro is only 12%, so this need to be increased. And renewable sources is of course increasing, which is 24%. These figures are dynamic. These are January 21, maybe now the contribution of renewable has been increased since then. Till 1990s, the power generation, distribution and transmission was in the government sector, popularly known as by electricity boards in each state. From 1990, the major power reforms came in the country, and the power sector was open to private sector. And presently, the contribution of power sector in generation is more than 47%. If we see the potential of wind and solar is more than 1 lakh megawatt. But we could harness only of the order of 40,000 megawatt. The small hydro potential is around 25,000 megawatt, and we could harness less than 5,000 megawatt. So we have to go a long way to develop more and more renewable energy power projects to meet our growing demand of electricity. Now for hydropower, if you talk for the power potential, it is the product of the discharge, the water which is falling in the, flowing in the stream in meter cube per second, multiply by the head, the height at which it is falling on the machines. So 9.81 into discharge into head multiplied by the efficiency is the power in kilowatt. The simple mechanism, the water from intake or a forebay, it falls on the turbine, and the level difference is the head which works on the turbine to generate electricity. As far as the efficiency of the machines are concerned, the efficiency of turbines are 88% to 94%, generator efficiency 96% to 98%, gearbox efficiency 98%, and the combined efficiency could be of the order of 75% to 80%. And with the modern machines, this efficiency are increasing. In case the speed of turbine and generator are the same, gearbox is not required. So that efficiency can be omitted in such cases. If for classification of the hydropower, it can be classified in many ways, like by the size. By the size, if you talk, pico hydro is up to 5 kilowatt, micro up to 100 kilowatt, mini up to 2000 kilowatt, small up to 25 megawatt, medium up to 50 megawatt, and large, of course, more than 50 megawatt. Or broadly, it is small and large. Up to 25 megawatt, it is a small, and more than 25 megawatt, it could be large. Another classification is based on the head. Low head, which is 3 meter to 30 meter. Medium head, 30 meter to 50 meter. And high head, above 50 meter. Although this definition is not universal. In different references, you may find different ranges of the low head, maybe up to 20 meter, 30 meter, or 40 meter. Similarly, the definition of small and large is not universal. In different countries, this range is different, which may vary from 3 megawatt to 50 megawatt. In China, the mandate of small hydro is up to 50 megawatt. In India, it is up to 25 megawatt, In some European countries, it is up to 3 MW. Then classification based on the purpose. If the power plant is only for power generation, that's a single purpose. If it is for flood control, water supply, irrigation, power generation, then it is multipurpose. Then classification by storage capacity is run of river. If the water which is flowing in the stream and same is utilized for power generation, is the run of river. Pond means where we have a small pondage for few hours in a day and empty the same day. Then seasonal, where we store the water during rainy season and use in other seasons. Then multi-year, there are some dams which are not filled in 1 year. In more than 1 year, they are filled. Then the function for generation, for pumping, or working in reversible mode, where the same machine can work for generation as well as pumping, which runs in pump mode as well as in turbine mode. The classification by service type to meet the base load requirement, peak loads, and intermittent demands. By system design means whether the power plant in a remote area working in a standalone, or it is grid connected and working in cascading. Then we can discuss the type of schemes, the runoff river, dam based, canal based, and pump storage. The runoff river schemes are those where we put a barrier named as diversion weir across the river, and from the river we divert the water for power generation. And this water leads to a tank called forebay, and from forebay to the powerhouse, it is conveyed by a passage pipe called penstock. And after power generation, the water leads to the main river. The canal-based, you may find in the country we have a large network of canals, mainly for irrigation purpose. And along the canal, you may find several falls. Like many of you might be belonging to Saurashtra region. In Saurashtra region is like a soup. In initial reaches, there is a drop along the Saurashtra Panch canal. And then there is a rise. So in initial reach of 30-40 kilometer, three power plants of 16 megawatts are planned. I don't know whether they have commissioned or not yet. And beyond that, large pumping stations are installed to lift the water so that it can reach to the tail end. So along the canal, wherever the fall is there, it becomes a potential source of energy generation. In Miyagam branch canal also, in Kutch branch canal also, there are small falls, maybe of 3 meter, 4 meter, 5 meter height, and where the power plants are planned to generate electricity. Then the dam to power stations. In the central and southern part of the country, like in Gujarat also, the water is available during rainy season only. So small tanks are built at many places to store the water, where the dams are built of the height of 10 to 40, 50 meters. So wherever such dams are there, we can take a penstock from the body of the dam and plan a power plant at the toe of the dam. Then comes the pump storage. Pump storage is the need of ours. In the pump storage, there are two reservoirs, one at high level, which we call upper reservoir, another at lower level, called the lower reservoir. The water runs from upper reservoir to generate electricity, and when surplus electricity is there, we pump the water from lower reservoir to fill the upper reservoir. In this case, we do not store the water in the upper reservoir, but we store the electricity, because this water can be used at any time to generate electricity. For such power plants, it's better if we have two water sources at high level and lower level, and where we construct the reservoir. Or there may be one source of water and another may be made, reservoir may be made at hilltop. Even at the lower level, if some discarded mine is there, that can also be used as the lower reservoir. Now, for resource assessment at different sites, it is a systematic, time-bound study where the data is shared between government, social and private sectors, and then we can assess the potential. So here, inventory of the all possible sites are made based on the discharge and head availability and topography. Then the priority or a ranking is made for the development. A cluster study can be made to identify number of plants in an area, and that also provide the financial requirement, because for each power plant the cost can be assessed. So we may know that how much cost may be required to develop all the power plants. Now, once the power plant is developed, for evacuation of power, the grid network is required. So that also has to go side by side, whether it's a strengthening of the existing power stations or putting the new grid lines. So before the power plant is complete, the grid network should be there for evacuation of power. Quite oftenly, no scientific or systematic attempts have been made to assess the full potential available for SHP development on a regional basis or state basis or certain area of the state. If a systematic study is not carried out, that should be made. Because sometimes we focus on individual sites. But if we plan the sites in the whole area, then an integrated development plan can be made for better utilization of the water, for power generation, for drinking, for irrigation, for industry development and other uses. And the issues related to the grid, availability of the finances, wheeling of energy, institutional aspects are also have to be looked into side by side. For potential assessment, several times the attempts were made. Central Electricity Authority made the first attempt in 1997. That time the mandate of India for a small hydro was up to 15 megawatt only. And that time the assessment was made that there are 1500 sites and the total potential is around 6782 megawatt. Again, our department, with the support of Power Finance Corporation, in 2003, made another attempt up to 15 megawatt, and we found that the sites are around 4,000 with more than 8,000 megawatt potential. Again, in 2010, when the mandate of small hydro was increased to 25 megawatt, our department made an attempt, and we find that there are 5,800 sites, and the potential is 16,000 megawatt. Now again, it was reassessed, and after reassessment, it is found that the small hydro potential is of the order of 25,000 megawatt. Normally, we know that the hydropower potential is available on the run-of-river schemes, on dam-based canals, like I have discussed now. But there are other facilities also where the hydropower can be developed. Like residual potential in pipelines for drinking and industrial use. We know that to supply the drinking water, we have a network where we draw the water, clean it, and supply it to the consumers. Now, certain head is required to reach this water at the tail end. If there is a surplus head, that can be used for power generation. The effluent from the water treatment plants or the sewage treatment plants, after treatment, when this water joins the water body, in between there may be a fall, which can be used for power generation. Now in our rivers, in our channels, the velocity of the flow can be used for hydrokinetic development. Now such turbines are available, which can be used for generation of electricity. I talked to the pump storage power plants. So it's not that we have a large capacity pump storage plant. A small scale pump storage of few megawatt can also be planned to reduce the diesel consumption. Because in many areas, in Gujarat also, in remote areas, for backup, we have the diesel generating sets. So if we have the pump storage power plants, so means they are also there for assured power supply. So that can be used for the backup power. When we carry out the study for power potential, it gives us the information on financially and technically feasibility. We also know what kind of investigations are more required, what kind of experience and expertise is required for the development. Presently, there are many computer-based tools are available which can be applicable or useful for preliminary assessment, but for reliable assessment, one has to go to the site for verification and ground truthing. Geographical information system, which is a software based with remote sensing, is also highly useful for preliminary planning. Because by digital elevation model, we can know the head. From the topographical survey sheet, we can find the catchment area. With the available rainfall data, we can predict the discharge. And also from digital elevation model, we can know the head. So we can assess the power. Now on GIS tool, we can make a map of the area where potential sites can be marked. Their priority can be marked, their cost can be marked, and also they can be marked along with the grid network. So that grid strengthening can also be planned. So for conventional method for the planning are the topographical maps, the discharge records, and field measurements. Now, for planning the power potential, we can use the conventional methods, available softwares, or a combination of them, and then we can go for ground truthing. Now, in this figure, you can see this is a topographical survey map. And on the topographical survey map, this blue line shows the perennial river where water flows around the year. The black line shows the rivers which are non-perennial, seasonal only, where the water is available during rainy season only. And this dark blue line, black line, it shows the catchment boundary. The catchment area which contributes runoff to this point. So this much area is contributing runoff to this point. So by knowing the catchment characteristics and the rainfall data, we can assess the discharge availability. Our department has carried out such a study for 13 hill states of the country, and where discharge data of 102 catchments were collected. And based on that, the flow duration curves were prepared for the streams which were ungauged, where measurements were not made. For each catchment, the hydropower potential was computed, and dependable flows for 50%, 75%, and 90% were assessed to predict the hydropower potential. Here you can see the cascade development. Along a river, we can have number of stations which can be storage based, or maybe some storage based and some non-storage. This was planned along the Narmada River in Madhya Pradesh area, which was sponsored by Narmada Valley Development Authority. And here you can see this longitudinal section of Narmada River, and where many power plants were planned, which were reservoir based and non-reservoir based. Here you can see, this is also the map of the Narmada Valley in Madhya Pradesh area. And here you can see all the dots, they show the possible power plants and along with the transmission line network. And their capacity is also written so that one can know whether the proper grid line is available near the power plant or it need to be strengthened. So these are the different layers which can be made on the GIS network. Here you can see a river in plain area with wider reach and a flat, almost flat slope. So naturally, if we need to plan on such a river, we need a long water conductor system, while in another case where we have a fall, then we can draw the water from the upstream, join in the downstream to generate power, and it needs a small length of the water conductor system. This is also a tributary where you can see the meandering. Now, a sharp bend in the river can be used for power generation. Like if you divert the water from here and join here, so it utilizes the water level of this reach. So along a river, we can plant several power stations depending on the level difference and water availability. Here you can see this is an hillock. Now, for development of the power, if we take a channel along the hill contour, the length is very large. But if you puncture this hillock by having a tunnel, the water conductor system, here we have a dam and here is the power station. So the water conductor system is smaller. So this could be the thing for power potential and planning. We can have several routes and several types. Now I come to the another aspect of this lecture, the investigations for small hydropower. In the small hydropower, in a typical run-of-river scheme, there are various components. Initially, a diversion pier to divert the water, as I shown earlier. Then to remove the silt from the water, there is a desilting chamber. Then a channel which leads water to the four-bay tank or a balancing reservoir. And from four-bay to the powerhouse, the water goes through a precise pipe which you call penstock. And after generation of the electricity, the water from the powerhouse, it goes to the tail dish. The whole area need to be surveyed. And for investigation, there are broadly three stages. Because for the quantum of the work, which is required based on the requirement, because it needs investment of time and money. So in the initial stage, we call a reconnaissance survey to prepare a pre-feasibility report. Once we find that the project is feasible, then we carry out the detailed survey and investigations and prepare the detailed project report or a feasibility report, which is important for taking the pre-investment decision. Once we find that the project is technically feasible and economically viable, then we go for the execution. So surveys are required in these three stages. All the surveys are the same, but their quantum of work is different. If we talk for a reconnaissance level survey, which is required for preparation of a pre-feasibility report, the purpose of a pre-feasibility report is to know the technical feasibility of the project and identification of critical issues. Hello?
Sir.
The slide is visible?
No, sir. No, sir. It is.
There is some.
Yes, sir. It is. Fine.
Because some other screen has come in between.
Yes.
आप लोग बोर तो फील नहीं कर रहे हैं?
नहीं बिल्कुल नहीं सर.
आई थिंक टू ब्रेक द मोनोटोनी इज देयर एनी क्विक क्वेश्चन
पार्टिसिपेंट्स इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चन यू कैन आस्क टू सर. Hello, participants.
Good morning, sir.
Hello, good morning.
Sir, I think you will discuss about the type of the generator generally using small hydropower in next slide.
Yes.
Maybe we'll discuss. You will discuss, no, sir?
Yes.
Okay, sure. Thank you, sir.
So during the reconnaissance stage we carry out the hydrological survey. The hydrological survey is the measurement of the discharge. The topographical survey is the mapping of the area. The geological survey is to know the geology of the area for stability of the structures. Then power load demand assessment and socio-economic survey. They are used to know the demand of the power and socio-economic status of the people in the area. And in the pre-feasibility study, the purpose is to know the head and discharge. So here all these surveys are not carried out in detail, but they are carried out in cursory. Cursory means to know the head, this can be known by altimeters. Altimeter is a very small instrument which can be carried in a pocket or a GPS. This also very GPS and altimeter, they are more or less similar. Altimeter gives the altitude of any place and GPS gives the three coordinates, longitude, latitude and altitude. So this can be used to know the level difference between two places. By engineering level, if we have an engineering level, so this level can be used to know the level difference. Then theodolite and total station. The theodolite is instrument which is used to know the angles, and the total station is the latest development, and this instrument bisects the focus of a particular object and it has inbuilt software which carry out the mapping. Whatever the instrument we have, by using that we can assess the head. Even by using the available survey maps, the water filled tubes. This water filled tube is a crude but accurate method to know the level difference. By using the existing maps, the maps can also be used to know the level difference. Here you can see this brown lines. These are known as the contours. They have a certain number, means the level falling on each line. And difference between two lines will give the level difference. During the preliminary surveys, by using any kind of instrument or method which is available, we can assess the head. And discharge measurement is also carried out once or twice so that in 2-3 months we can prepare a pre-feasibility report. Now the second, when we prepare a pre-feasibility report and we find that the project is feasible for further investigations, then we go for detailed survey and investigations. And in detailed survey and investigations, like hydrological survey, in hydrological survey, discharge is measured daily for at least 2 years. Why 2 years? Because the water availability may not be the same every year. So some averaging may be there. It is better if we have the discharge measurement for 4, 5 years, 10 years. We have the longer data, it will be beneficial. For hydrological survey, there are methods which we call the indirect method and direct method. Indirect methods are the velocity area method and wear method. And direct method is salt dilution method. In the indirect method, which is the wear method, we can construct a rectangular wear or a triangular wear. Triangular wear is constructed at a very small stream, and a little bigger stream we have a rectangular wear. And every day the person who is responsible for discharge measurement, he need to measure the water depth, because width is constant. And by measuring the water depth, by using the formula given here, discharge can be assessed in meter cube per second. Similarly, in triangular notch or a triangular wear, the formula can be used by having the water depth to compute the discharge. Then in a wider streams, which are undulated, and it is not feasible to construct a wear, area velocity method is used, where area of cross section is measured and velocity of the flow is measured by a float method or by having a current meter. Nowadays, digital current meters are available, which gives the average velocity. And average velocity multiplied by the water by the area gives us the discharge. See, theoretically, the velocity is zero at the boundaries, which increases as we go away from the boundary. But it is not maximum at the surface, because at the surface we have resistance from the atmosphere. So maximum velocity is slightly below the water surface. So that's why we need to have the average velocity. And average velocity multiplied by the area is the discharge. Now the direct method is the salt dilution method, which is very accurate, up to 99%. But it is the present instrument is limited up to 4 m³/s of the discharge, not for the large discharges. Now here what is done? The water has certain base electrical conductivity. When we add salt to the water, the conductivity increases. Now due to the flow, dilution takes place, which brings back this electrical conductivity to the base level. And this change in the conductivity is calibrated into the discharge. So we choose a site. At one end, we pour the water which is mixed with the salt. At another end, we dip the probe of the instrument which senses the change in conductivity and convert it into discharge. The quantity of the salt depends on the cross-section area of the stream and the base ground conductivity of the water. And this is the normal salt which we eat to know the quantity of the, to know the discharge value. Now I come to the topographical survey. The topographical survey is the mapping of the area This is a topographical survey map. On the map, we can see the river, whether it's a perennial or it is a non-perennial. Then it also shows the ground features like the railway lines, roads, transmission lines, the residential area, the agriculture field, forest area. All such kind of ground features are marked on this map. And this brown lines, this shows the contour, means the line of equal height. So every line is marked with certain level, means this is 1000, means everywhere along this line, the altitude is 1000. So along the river, if we have a weir here, powerhouse here, the level difference gives us the head. And also here we can mark the layout of the project, how the channel will go, where the weir will be constructed, where the powerhouse will be constructed, so it can make a alignment on the topographical survey map. And nowadays the total station is used for such topographical surveys. Then comes the geological survey. The geological investigations has to be made by a geologist. The whole area where we need to plan different components of the hydropower scheme is to be visited by the geologist and which assess the geology of the area. Like for suitability of the weirs, the foundation mass should be impermeable, means any kind of joint, the fractured rock mass should not be there from where the leakage may take place. The narrow valley means the lesser width of the river is preferable because that will have the small length of the weir structure. Slope stability is also very important. The landslide. The area should not be landslide prone, otherwise the lot of muck may come and which may endanger the stability of the structure. So site need to be selected carefully so that it is free from the defects and leakage of the water, and there should not be any threat to the safety and stability. Now in some cross sections you may see that these are the loose deposits which are in the form of the residual soil or maybe landslips or glacial moraine or rock creep. So these need to be removed, and below which, where we have the sound rock, that is used for construction of the weir structure. Now come to the low demand survey and socio-economic survey. These surveys are not required for grid connected schemes, because if our plant is grid connected, then whatever is the generation, the same will fed to the grid. In case we are planning a power station in a remote area in isolated mode, so naturally the generation will depend on the demand. So in that case, demand assessment is made. The requirement of electricity may be for domestic needs, for street lighting, commercial establishments, markets, institutions like schools, post offices, banks, government offices, industries. So whatever is the source of electricity consumption, we need to make assessment of their load requirement and assess the present load demand assessment. Now this is not sufficient, because the area where electricity is not there, in initial planning, the people may be happy with the minimum load demand. Once the electricity is available and they are economically well off, the load demand will increase sharply with the time. So that's why the survey on socio-economic aspect is also important, where one need to survey their socio-economic status. What is their paying capacity? What is their income? If their income is good, they can add more appliances which will consume more electricity, and whatever we have planned today, maybe in 2, 3, 5 years, more demand will be there and more electricity need to be added. So in the planning of such isolated power plant, we have to be careful. It is not only to be planned for the present load demand, but also we have to cater the growing demand for the future. Like if the present demand is 100 kilowatt and we have developed the power plant for 100 kilowatt, and after 5 years the demand grows to 200 kilowatt, so we cannot say that we'll supply only the 50% demand. We have to augment our system for 200 kilowatt or as per the requirement, so that we can supply the quality power all 24/7. Then comes the meteorological survey. Now, meteorological surveys are generally required for large schemes. In small schemes, this can be done to know the discharge, because at many places the discharge measurements are not done. So to know the discharges, we need the catchment area and the rainfall data. To make assessment of the discharge and flood, because flood assessment is important for design of the weir which is constructed across the river, and also the power plant, because power plants are installed on the bank of the river. But the meteorological data are available with the Indian Meteorological Department at Pune, and the data is not very costly. So these can be taken from them. Then comes the construction material survey. The major requirement of the construction material is like cement, coarse aggregates, fine aggregates, brick, stone, steel, timber, fabricated steel items. So we need to identify their sources, their relative cost, so that in design of the structures, we can make use of more locally available material so that the construction becomes faster and cheaper. Then comes the power evacuation line survey. From the power station, the power need to be evacuated and joined with the nearby substation. So this is a kind of topographical survey where a route for the transmission line is surveyed. Then muck disposal is the same. During the construction, lot of waste material is generated, and this waste material need to be disposed of. It should not be disposed in the water body. We need to identify certain area nearby the project site where it can be disposed of without disturbing the environment and ecology of the area. Then comes the environmental survey. Normally, the environmental survey is not required for the scheme which is up to 25 megawatt or the small scheme. But if any scheme falls in the reserve forest area, then the environment impact assessment is carried out and environment mitigation plan is prepared. To know how much adverse impact our project will be making on the environment and how it will be mitigated. Sometimes the cost on mitigation may be very high. If our project is more than 25 megawatt, then it is mandatory to carry out EIA and AMP and clearance from Ministry of Environment and Forest, Survey of India is must. Now here, the effect of foundation and submergence is studied on the area. Lot of trees may cut, so impact of the deforestation. Scaring or defacing of the natural surrounding, especially in the region of borrow pits and quarry sites. The quarry sites or borrow pits are there, those from where we take the soil for construction activities. Reservation of cultural and ancient devices. Effect on stream flow in terms of its quality, because if we are storing, then lot of minerals and fertile material may be stored there and it is not available in the downstream. So it changes the quality of the water in downstream in terms of organic matter content, temperature, dissolved solid contents, etc. So a detailed study on these aspects are carried out and prepare a environment impact assessment and environment mitigation plan. Now, once we prepare a detailed project report and we take a decision for execution. During execution also, we need the topographical surveys to mark the different components. So the earlier topographical survey can be used here. Testing of construction material. The construction material which is used as per the designs, their strength need to be known, which can be carried out by testing of the material. The pillars are set to monitor and to control the levels at different places. Then subsoil exploration or geotechnical investigations are also required, which is needed to know the bearing capacity of the soil and other soil parameters, which are required for structural designs. So this subsoil exploration, they are costlier, and generally they are carried out once we go for construction. So this is a pre-construction activity for using these parameters for design purposes. Now briefly, I touch upon on the site selection also. Like for the site selection, if you go for a canal-based scheme or a dam-based scheme, it is simple because we have to plan our power plant near the fall or the dam. So we do not have much choice. But in case of a run-of-river scheme, we have many choices. As we go higher for the construction of weir, and as we go in the downstream for construction of power station, the head may increase. Increasing the head means the increase in the power. But for a suitable site of the intake, it should be a narrow valley, bend should be avoided, bank should be stable, no landslides, and minimum turbulence in the flow. Like here, we have a bend. So bend should be avoided. This could be a suitable place to locate the weir, because during high flows, the flow has a tendency to flow straight. It will strike the outer bend, which may get breached. And during low flows, there are chances of siltation at the inner bend. If there is a wider reach, means the more length of the weir. If this area is landslide prone, so due to landslide, lot of muck may deposit in the stream and it will be difficult to divert the water. So that's why it is not there that at any place along the river, we can locate this weir structure. Now for having a desilting tank, four bay, channel, spillway, we should try to find a flatter land. Otherwise, a lot of cutting may involve. Free from cross drainage. Cross drainage is the small streams crossing the alignment where cross drainage structure need to be constructed. The area should be free from the active slide zones. And slope should be stable, otherwise our structure may be, the safety may be endangered. For a spillway, if there is a natural stream in the nearby area, it can be used to spill the water. For penstock, it's better to align along the ridge, shortest length and minimum bands. And for powerhouse, easily accessibility, flatter ground, above high flood level, and stable slope. Like the penstock connects the four bay with the powerhouse. In the hills, the raised portion is known as ridge, and depressed portion is known as valley. If you construct the penstock along the valley, there are chances of flow of water during rainy season, where it may destabilize the penstock supports. If the length is more, the cost will be more, and also the head loss will be more due to friction. So that's why the penstock should be aligned along the ridge with shortest length and lesser number of bends. Powerhouse should be well above the flood level, so that during flood, the water should not enter through tail rates in the powerhouse. Lot of machinery equipment are to be transported to the powerhouse, so it should be well accessible. And relatively we have flatter area so that the cutting is less. So these are the things which we have to keep in mind while locating the site for different components and the whole scheme. So this is all which I need to